Amen. I remain standing for God's word. We continue today in our study of Ecclesiastes, and we will be in chapter 9. If you have your Bibles, I would encourage you to turn there, and we will read verses 1 through 12. Beginning then in verse 1. But all this I laid to heart, examining it all, how the righteous and the wise and their deeds are in the hand of God. Whether it is love or hate, man does not know. Both are before him. It is the same for all, since the same event happens to the righteous and the wicked, to the good and the evil, to the clean and the unclean, to him who sacrifices and him who does not sacrifice. As the good one is, so is the sinner, and he who swears is as he who shuns an oath. This is an evil in all that is done under the sun, and the same event happens to all. Also, the hearts of the children of man are full of evil, and madness is in their hearts while they live. And after that, they go to the dead. But he who is joined with all the living has hope, for a living dog is better than a dead lion. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing, and they have no more reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. Their love and their hate and their envy have already perished, and forever they have no more share in all that is done under the sun. Go, eat your bread with joy and drink your wine with a merry heart, for God has already approved what you do. Let your garments be always white, let not oil be lacking on your head. Enjoy life with the wife whom you love all the days of your vain life that he has given you under the sun, because that is your portion in life and in your toil at which you toil under the sun. Whatever your hands find to do, do it with your might, for there is no work or thought or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol to which you are going. Again, I saw that under the sun the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to the intelligent, nor favor to those with knowledge, but time and chance happen to them all. For man does not know his time. Like fish that are taken in an evil net, and like birds that are caught in a snare, so the children of man are snared at an evil time when it suddenly falls upon them. This is the word of God, which you pray with me. God, we turn again to your word, the source of all truth, and knowledge and wisdom, and we pray now that we would be a people willing to receive with eagerness what the word has for us, that we would be a people that would be willing to count our days and realize that this earthly life does come to an end to all who believe and those who don't. And may your servant, Pastor Trent, now speak boldly and courageously for the hope that this book holds for us, and that we might be transformed, Lord, by your Holy Spirit, for without that help, we are a hopeless people. We commit this time to you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
What have I become, my sweetest friend? Everyone I know goes away in the end, and you could have it all, my empire of dirt. If I could start again, a million miles away, I would keep myself, I would find a way.
For those of you who are regulars at Covenant, you've been here for a number of years, you know that this is the time of year we typically drop into one service, and we combine our early service and our late service because we're small enough to be able to fit everybody in the sanctuary at the same time. Well, you're wondering, why haven't we done that yet? And the answer is because we're not small enough to do that yet. And so we really enjoy when we can go back to one service and all worship in the same place and have fellowship all together. But this is a great problem. There are too many of you, between our two services. And so don't stop coming to church so that the rest of us can all worship in one room. We're really glad you're here, but you've been wondering why we haven't done that. That's the reason. So we're excited to see what God is doing and continues to bring people here to worship and be a part of this family. I want to tell you about a song. It was recorded back in 2004 by the country music legend Tim McGraw. And this song went on to top the country music Billboard charts. It won the Country Music Association Song of the Year. It won a Grammy for Best Country Song. It was a big deal. And the basics of the song are that it's about a man who got a terminal diagnosis in his early 40s. And the song is about how that terminal diagnosis shaped the way the man began to live his life. And in the course of the song, the man asked the terminally diagnosed man, you know, how did this news hit you? What happened? How did your life change as a result of this news? And this is what he sings. I was finally the husband that most of the time I wasn't. And I became a friend would like to have. And all of a sudden, going fishing wasn't such an imposition. And I went 3 times that year I lost my dad. Well, I finally read the good book, and I took a good, long, hard look at what I'd do if I'd do it all again. Now, I'd sing it for you, but I want to put Tim McGraw out of a job, so I'll just read it. This is what he said. He said, I went skydiving. I went Rocky Mountain climbing. I went 2.7 seconds on a bull named Fu Manchu. And I loved deeper, and I spoke sweeter, and I gave forgiveness I'd been denying. And he said, someday, I hope you'll get the chance to live like you were dying. We might wonder whether or not those are exactly the kinds of things a person ought to do if they find out that they're dying, if that's the best way to live one's life. But the point of the song is basically the same point that the writer of Ecclesiastes is making for us here in this passage. The point is this. You don't know when your time is coming. But you can be sure of this, your time is coming. And wisdom is to begin to live like you're dying, because you are. So live wisely. Live like you're dying. And he's going to lay out for us at least 3 different ways in this passage that we can begin to incorporate that and start to allow our lives now to be shaped by the one certainty in life that you're going to die. So how do we live wisely in light of that knowledge? So there's 3 things he's going to show us. The first is we have to embrace the reality that that is true. We are going to die. Secondly, we need to enjoy the life that we do have. And then thirdly, we need to be prepared to die when that time comes. So let's start at the beginning. First of all, embrace the reality you are dying. This is not news. If you've been studying Ecclesiastes with us since we started this series, we've kind of been beating that horse. It's a dead horse, and you'll be dead like that horse soon. Not to put too fine a point on it, but that, you know, he tells us this repeatedly. Why? Because we need to be reminded continually if we're going to live wisely, that this does not go on indefinitely. A time will come when you're going to die. But he does add some twists or some additional light on that reality in this passage. And the first thing he wants us to see is that God is sovereign over the events of your life, including the time of your death. So he writes in verse 1, "But all this I laid to heart, examining it all, how the righteous and the wise and their deeds are in the hand of God." Everything about the lives of the righteous and the wise and all of your works, all of these things are in the hand of God, which means they're not in your hand. Your life and everything about it is in God's hand. It's in his control. The hand of God is the place of power. And if you read and trace that theme of the hand of God throughout Scripture, you'll see that sometimes the hand of God is something of a fearful thing. Sometimes it's a comforting thing, but it's always a powerful reality. You're in God's hand, and so are all your works. Now, we tend to think that if we strike it rich, God has blessed us. And if we get a cancer diagnosis, that God is doing bad to us. But what he goes on to show us in this next verse is that we don't know. We don't know, based on the circumstances of our life, whether any particular circumstance is a reflection of God's love for us or of God's hatred. Look what he says in the rest of verse 1 and following. He says, whether it is love or hate, man does not know. Both are before him. It is the same for all, since the same event happens to the righteous and the wicked, to the good and the evil, to the clean and the unclean, to him who sacrifices and him who does not sacrifice. As the good one is, so is the sinner. And he who swears is as he who shuns an oath. This is an evil in all that is done under the sun, that the same event happens to all. Everyone dies. The righteous and the wicked, the ones who sacrifice and those who don't, the ones who live morally uprightly and the ones who live disastrously wicked lives. The same event happens to all. And so, not just that final event, but the other kinds of events leading up to that happen to all. It's difficult for us to look at the circumstances of our lives and from those circumstances determine whether or not God is for us or against us. Simplistic religion says, if I'm good, if I'm clean, if I'm righteous, if I do the right things, my life will go smooth and easy and I won't have hard things happen to me. But wisdom literature like Ecclesiastes, the book of Job, and others give us a fuller perspective. And the reality is, suffering happens to the righteous and the wicked. Financial hardship, cancer diagnosis, miscarriages, economic depression. These are all things that happen to the righteous and the wicked alike. You can't look at the circumstances of your life and say, because this happened to me, God doesn't like me. God's not for me. God is punishing me. You can't do that. How can we know if God is for us or against us? How can we know if he loves us or he hates us if we can't look at the circumstances around ourselves and determine it? We can know God is for us not by looking at our circumstances, but by looking to the cross. We can know God is for us not by whether or not I get diagnosed or whether or not I live to a good old age. We can know that God is for us by looking to the cross. That's why we keep it prominently displayed here and on the top of our building, because it is the one certainty about how God feels toward you. The Bible says that in love, God gave his only son to die on the cross for your sins so that you could be forgiven and reconciled to God and have eternal life with him starting now. That's how God feels about you. He gave his son for you that you might know him and truly experience life as it was meant to be, freed from the guilt and shame of all of our sin. Hard things will happen to you. You trust in Jesus, you will have trouble. Jesus himself said it. In this world, you will have trouble. But don't let the trouble cause you to define how God feels about you. Allow the cross to define for you how God feels about you. And know that the cross says love. He's for you, not against you. The second thing that this passage invites us to consider is that death is the consequence of sin. We're going to embrace the reality that we're dying and that death is the consequence of sin. He says, you know, we might not know why the righteous suffer and why the wicked flourish, but we do know why death comes. And he says in verse 3 and continuing, he says, this is an evil and all that is done under the sun, the same event happens to all. Also, the hearts of the children of man are full of evil, and madness is in their hearts while they live. And after that, they go to the dead. This is not typically your bumper sticker kind of verse. The hearts of children of man are full of evil. Madness is in their hearts while they live, and then they die. It's pretty stark. And but what he's saying is, whether you're old or you're young, whatever the color of your skin, however rich or not wealthy you are, whatever your background, wherever you were raised, your heart is full of evil. And consequently, you're a little bit insane because you're participating in this grand rebellion against the God of the universe. It's crazy. It's madness. And every time you sin, you're demonstrating just how crazy you are. And then you die. Now, you might be sitting out there and saying, like, you know, this is that crazy Christian fundamentalism that's always looking for the bad in everybody, and you're always finding a reason to tell us we're terrible people and so on. That's not what I'm trying to do. But what the Bible tells us is from the beginning, from Adam and Eve, and from their first rebellion, not only they, but all the rest of humanity has been corrupted by sin. To say you're full of evil doesn't mean you're as evil as you possibly could be, but it means every single part of you is tainted by sin. There's nothing you can do that doesn't have the tinges of evil to it. Listen, one of the most progressive theologians of the 20th century, who would disagree with many of the things we say from this pulpit every week, a man named Reinhold Niebuhr, even he, after World War II, had to agree with this statement that was written in the literary London Times literary piece. He says, "The doctrine of original sin is the only empirically verifiable doctrine of the Christian faith." In other words, all you have to do is look at history, and you can see that original sin is real. All you have to do is raise a child, and you can see that there's something twisted about that cute little heart. All you have to do is look in the mirror at yourself, and you can see that there is something that's not right. Maybe many things. The Bible just tells us the truth as it is. We've got a problem. It's evil. It's sin. It's the madness that comes forth from that. And the consequence of that sin and evil is death. God promised it to Adam and Eve. In the day that you eat of the fruit that I'm forbidding you to eat, you will surely die. And he's talking about a spiritual death, and he's talking about a physical death. And in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death." And from that day of Adam and Eve's fall in the garden until now, God has been paying the wages that our sin deserves. And every single one, from that time to this, with the exception of two, have died. Well, you might be a Christian out there today, and you say to yourself, "I understand the wages of sin is death, but I believe Jesus died on the cross for my sins, that he's taken my sins away, that he bore the judgment in my place, that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." That's absolutely true. Okay, well then why do I still die if my sin is forgiven? Well, the Westminster Larger Catechism answers that question helpfully. It says this: "The righteous shall be delivered from death at the last day, and even in death are delivered from the sting and curse of it. So that although they die, yet it is out of God's love to free them perfectly from sin and misery and to make them capable of further communion with Christ in glory, which they then enter upon." So the Christian still dies, but they do not die as an act of God's wrath and judgment upon our sin. But actually, when the Christian dies, it is the act of God's love to deliver us from the body of sin, to deliver us from our struggle against sin, to deliver us from the miseries of this life, to perfect our souls as our bodies wait in the grave, still united to Christ, only to be raised in glory and further perfected to live in the new heavens and the new earth forever. He brings us through death so that we can experience a communion with Christ that we can't experience right now. But when we trace the ultimate cause of death, it traces back to the reality of sin in the world, and consequently, all die. The third thing that he shows us in this passage is that death is the end of earthly opportunity. He writes in verse 4, "But he who is joined with the living has hope, for a living dog is better than a dead lion. For the living know that they will die, but the dead know nothing, and they have no more reward, for the memory of them is forgotten. Their love and their hate and their envy have already perished, and forever they have no more share in all that is done under the sun. A living dog is better than a dead lion." At the time the preacher was writing this, dogs didn't have the same positive reputation they have in our culture. Dogs were seen as the lowest of the low, and lions, of course, were highly esteemed. But his point is, better to be a living dog than a dead lion. And the reason, essentially, better to be alive than dead. Now, we have to balance that with what the Apostle Paul tells us in the New Testament, that ultimately to depart and be with Christ is far better. But the writer of Ecclesiastes is helping us to see things from a particular perspective under the sun. And he says, this is the advantage the living have over the dead. This is the advantage. The living know that they will die. But the dead are already dead. So as long as you're alive, you have the advantage of knowing you're going to die. But once you're dead, it's too late. Why is that an advantage? The advantage is, as long as you're alive, you still have the opportunity to live your life wisely in light of the fact that you're going to die. But once you're dead, you can't do that anymore. The opportunity's gone. You're dead. But now you can begin to take advantage of opportunities that are before you. Now you can begin to live as a person who knows that they're dying and live wisely. There's a time coming. Listen, life in heaven, in the new heavens and the new earth, resurrection body, I mean, it is going to be fantastic what awaits us. But in many ways, there will be similarities, but there will be some differences. We enter heaven and life in the new world as it's supposed to be. For example, you will not be able to lead your friends and family members to faith in Jesus Christ in heaven. The opportunity for that is now. You won't have that opportunity. Jesus said, we must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. Today you have the opportunity to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to heal the sick in a way that you will not have once you're dead. Today, you have the opportunity to invest in the advancement of God's kingdom in a way that you will not have once you're dead. That day is today. Today, you can store up treasures in heaven, but once you're in heaven, it's too late. Today, you can be a part of the advancement of the Great Commission. Not then. You have opportunities now to do things you will not be able to do. So recognize that that day is coming and live wisely now with the opportunities that are before you. The first piece of living wisely and living like you're dying is to embrace the reality that you're dying. Do you believe it? Is it a visceral reality to you? If we've embraced that reality, then how should we live? Well, that's the second thing he wants us to see, and it's this. Enjoy the life you're living. Embrace the fact that you're dying, and then enjoy the life you're living. The Latin word made famous in that great Robin Williams movie, The Dead Poets Society, is carpe diem, seize the day. I won't say everything about that philosophy is totally Christian, but this is something at what the writer's getting at. Seize the day. There are opportunities before you today. They will not always be before you. There are opportunities to enjoy things today that will not always be before you. So enjoy the life that he's given you. Enjoy the life you have. That begins with enjoying the simple pleasures of life. Look at verse 7. Go, eat your bread with joy. Drink your wine with a merry heart, for God has already approved what you do. Now, this is the sixth time that the preacher has told us some version of this. Just like he tells us frequently, you're going to die, he frequently tells us, enjoy your food and drink in this life that you've been given. But he adds a note of urgency here. It starts with the imperative, go. Go. And don't just eat your bread, but eat it with joy. Enjoy it. I don't know about you, I have a tendency sometimes to think about food purely as fuel. And the helpful thing about that is it helps me eat things I wouldn't want to eat otherwise, but I know they're good for me. But we're supposed to see food as something to be enjoyed. So enjoy it. And likewise, don't just drink your wine, but drink it with a merry heart. Enjoy it. On what basis? He says, God's already approved what you do. Verse 7. The righteous don't have to wonder if God is happy with them enjoying food and drink. These are gifts he's given you to enjoy. He expects you to enjoy them. And what if one day you have to answer him the question, why did you not enjoy the good gifts I gave you? Well, because I was being righteously religious. He will not be impressed. He's already approved what you do. These are good gifts he's given for you to open and to enjoy them. And he's not only approved what you do, but if your faith is in Jesus, he's already approved of you. You're accepted. You're loved. You're his child. He loves you. He loves to see you delight in the things that delight him. Think about this. Those of you who are parents, how do you feel when your kids are absolutely delighted in a gift that you've given them? Are you like, oh, you should be more righteous? No, you're like, that's exactly why I gave it to you. So God delights in our delight when we delight in the simple gifts that he has given us. Enjoy your food and enjoy your drink. They're good gifts to you. He goes on and says, let your garments be always white, and let not oil be lacking on your head. You know, the sign of mourning and sadness was to wear sackcloth and to wear ashes and to not anoint one's head with oil. And we might think, we get the terminal diagnosis that Ecclesiastes gives us, you're dying. You might think the right response to that is to mourn, to weep, to go around in sackcloth and ashes and to be sad and bitter and angry about the reality. And yet he tells us precisely the opposite. Embrace the fact that you're dying and then put on your festival clothes and put oil in your head and let your life be marked with joy. That's just this book just is constantly turning everything upside down and around on us. We don't think like this, and that's why God gave us the word to teach us how to think and teach us what wisdom looks like. This doesn't mean, of course, that we can't be sad and there aren't times for weeping and mourning. We see that in the scripture. But the dominant note of our lives as the children of God who know that we're going to die and that he's given all these gifts to enjoy in this life as a foretaste of what's still coming should be joy. Should be joy. These gifts, and the other ones we're going to talk about, they're not the final gifts. These gifts are a foretaste of better gifts that are yet still coming. And that doesn't mean we can't enjoy the gifts we have right now. In fact, knowing that better gifts are coming deepens our enjoyment of the ones we have right now. David Gibson writes and captures this powerfully. He says, those without Christ often abandon themselves to eating and drinking because sometimes it looks like that's as if there's all there is to do before we die. But those who love Christ cherish eating and drinking because it looks a little like what we will do after we die. That's right. We're going to what the Bible describes as a feast. And every time we enjoy our bread and our food, our drink as we eat here is a little bit of a foretaste, just a glimpse of a much deeper joy and a much greater gift that we will get to unwrap and enjoy forever. It's a foretaste. Enjoy the simple gifts. Secondly, and that's not an exhaustive list, food and drink. There are all kinds of simple gifts. Enjoy them. Secondly, enjoy companionship. And the focus of the next verses we're going to read is marriage, and that's what I'm going to focus on as well. But for those of you who aren't married and who'll never be married, one of the great gifts about marriage is companionship, and that's something we can enjoy through friendships and with relatives and others in our lives. And this is a gift for you to enjoy as well. But this is what he says about marriage in verse 9. Enjoy life with the wife whom you love all the days of your vain life that he has given you under the sun, because that is your portion in life and in your toil at which you toil under the sun. Look carefully at what he says. He does not say, endure life with the wife you're stuck with all the days of your vain life. Put up with the husband that God gave you. Love the one you're with. No, no. Enjoy life with the wife whom you love all the days of your vain, in this case meaning fleeting, life that God has given you. Enjoy life. Now, if this were simple, marriage and divorce statistics wouldn't be what they are today. So we can appreciate and recognize this is not simple. It's not easy. It's true. And we should long for this. We should aspire to this. We should receive this, embrace this. But I don't mean to say that it's easy. In fact, many of God's good gifts to us, many of the things that you enjoy in this world are not easy. If you want to enjoy a sport, tennis, for example, it takes work. It takes effort. It's not particularly fun to stink at the game. You have to stink for a long time before you're good at it. But then you really start to enjoy it. Or the same with a musical instrument or speaking a foreign language. There's a period of time where it just feels like work, where it doesn't necessarily feel like it's giving anything back to you, but that's an important part. That's part of the development. That's one of the stages. Why should we think that relationships, some of God's best gifts, marriage, wouldn't entail effort, work, maybe even a period of stinking until we get to the place where it's really sweet? So if it feels like that to you, you're not necessarily doing it wrong. It's effort, it's work, it's a challenge. Now, some of us aren't enjoying the life that God has given us with the spouse that he's given us because we're too busy. And if we're too busy to enjoy life with the wife whom God has given us, then we're too busy. And some of us are too busy because we say to ourselves, well, we got kids in the home, and that just is like, it's too busy. And to be clear, raising children to be fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ, raising them in the love and admonition of the Lord Jesus, to be disciples, that is paramount importance for Christian parents. But that's not usually what's keeping us too busy to enjoy life with the spouse whom God has given us. Much more frequently in my own experience and what I've seen is we're too busy because we're involved in every extracurricular activity under the sun. And we're driving all over the county or the state or the country doing all the stuff. Somehow thinking that in all of that stuff, joy is to be found when the place where God says joy is to be found is enjoying life with the wife whom God has given you. Do not sacrifice your marriage for your kids. Do not. We are called as parents to make sacrifices. Make no mistake. We are called to make sacrifices. You're never called to sacrifice your marriage for your kids. That's not a sacrifice God asked you to make. Don't sacrifice your marriage for your kids, but invest in your marriage for your kids. There is nothing you can do more for your kids to help them in life than to give them a stable home with two parents who love each other, who love the Lord, and who are teaching them how to love Jesus and modeling what that looks like. There's nothing better you can do for your kids. So invest in that. Work at that. Pour yourself into that relationship. There's a reason why many divorces happen right after the kids leave home. One of those reasons is because the marriage relationship got sacrificed for the sake of the kids. And that doesn't ultimately serve the kids. So don't neglect your marriage, especially those of you who have kids in the home. Invest in it. Work at it. What does that look like? Well, begin to enjoy life with the wife whom God has given you. And start today. And for some of you, starting today means that you go out from this place, or you even come up here to the front after the service today, and you say to God, God, I am sorry for not recognizing that the portion you gave me to enjoy is my spouse. And I've been thinking that it's in my career, or I've been thinking that it's in my kids primarily, or I've been thinking that it's in my hobby. And here she is right in front of me all this time, taken for granted. Forgive me. And maybe it involves going to your spouse and saying, I'm sorry that I've put my work before you. I'm sorry that I've put our kids before you. I'm sorry that I've put my parents before you. I'm sorry that I've put whatever it is before you. And today I'm going to make a change. Will you forgive me for not enjoying life with you like God invites us to do? And for some of you, it means that starting today, you're going to go to the Lord and say, I'm ready to let go of the bitterness and the resentment that I have in my heart toward my spouse. And maybe it's about something they did years ago. Maybe it's not about any one particular thing, but it's just a series of things. You just have this gradually building up in you over time, this sense of resentment and bitterness that they are not what you signed up for. And you have no idea the impact that that is having on them. It's killing your marriage. Listen, the reality is you're probably not what they signed up for either. Nobody signed up for bitterness and resentment and for feeling like they don't measure up. Nobody signed up for any of that. But listen, if the gospel is true, and it is, if the Lord can forgive you for your sins, there is grace there for you to forgive what's been done to you. I'm not saying it's easy. I'm not saying it's a quick fix. I'm not saying that there aren't trust issues and so on that have. I'm saying, are you willing today to say, this is God's portion for me? And I'm tired of not enjoying the good gift that he has given to us. And I'm willing to do whatever it takes. Starting today, I will go to counseling. We will go to counseling together. We'll go on that marriage retreat. We'll plan that time, that getaway for just the two of us that we've been neglecting. We're going to do what it takes because this is what he says is our good portion. We're going to enjoy life together from this point forward. And we're going to do the hard work to get to the joy. Thirdly, enjoy work. Enjoy work. Verse 10, whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might, for there is no work or thought or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol to which you're going. Sheol is that Old Testament Hebrew word for the realm of the dead. It's like the Greek word for Hades. It's not a statement about heaven or hell per se. It's just there's the land of the living, life under the sun, and then there's the land of the dead, Sheol. And so he's saying essentially, again, you have opportunity in this life to do things that are meaningful. Do it with your might. Don't do it half-heartedly. Life is too short for you to be slothful in the meaningful things God has given you to do and to be busy about. So as you go about working on your marriage, do it with all your might. As you go about your vocation, whatever God's called you to do, go at it with all your might. As you raise your kids, go at it with all your might. This week was such a blessing to me. I got to see many of you here at this church giving it all your might to serve these kids at VBS. And some of you served with all your might, so much so that you're having to watch online this morning because you got no might left after this week. That is a beautiful thing to behold. Your life has been given to you to spend. Spend it. Spend it. Give your life. The Great Commission is worth giving your life for. The evangelization of your lost friends and neighbors is worth giving yourself to. The education of children and the Christian faith is worth giving yourself to. So whatever your hand finds to do, do it with your might. Thirdly, if you're going to live wisely, be ready when the time comes. Again, to quote David Gibson, because he just hits the nail on the head, he says, we tend to live life as if the one thing that is certain will never come, while the many things that are uncertain are certain. The one thing that's certain is that you're going to die, and that's the one thing we live life as if, like, we're not totally sure it's going to happen to me. But then all these other things that are uncertain, we're like, I know this is going to happen. I know this is what I'm going to do, and this is where I'm going to be, and this is how my life's going to turn out, and this is... And the preacher here disabuses of both those notions. The first thing he tells us is that time and chance happen to us all. Look with me at verse 11. Again, I saw that under the sun, the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to the intelligent. By the way, if you have riches or bread, what's this saying about you? That was a slight funny insult. Nor favor to those with knowledge, but time and chance happen to them all. Is the swift don't always win? Now, of course, most of the time they do. He says, the wise don't always have bread, but of course, most of the time they do. The intelligent don't always get riches, but most of the time they do. His point is, these things aren't certain. There's a sense in which we expect them because that is normally how the world works. But they're not certain. And we should quit living our life thinking that they are certain. You are responsible for the things you do, the decisions you make, and the way you spend your time, but you are not sovereign over the outcomes of your life. You're 100% responsible for what you do with the life God has given you, but you aren't responsible for the outcomes. You're not sovereign over that. And so that means we ought to be careful where we put our hope. We have to be careful where we put our hope. And in fact, wisdom means not putting our hope in anything under the sun, but beyond the sun, putting our hope in that which is certain. The promises that are offered to us in the gospel, and to live our lives that way. Then we can pursue meaningful goals and activities and make the most of the life God has given to us and work at whatever we work at with all our might. But regardless of the outcome, we have a hope and a confidence that isn't affected by the things that happen in this world. Secondly, we do not know our time. Verse 12. For man does not know his time, like fish that are taken in an evil net and like birds that are caught in a snare. So the children of man are snared at an evil time when it suddenly falls upon them. You know, the fish is happily making his way through the sea when suddenly he says, "What's this? I'm caught in a net." Lights out. The bird's happily pecking along, eating his worms and dirt off the ground. Suddenly the snare snaps him up. His life is over. And so he says, you go through your life happily swimming along, pecking about at the dirt and whatever it is that you do, and it's over. At a time when you don't expect, you don't see it coming. Sometimes we see it coming. But even those times when we see it coming, it's still something of a surprise when it actually happens. You might know some of these stories. The man, a French playwright named Molière, he wrote a play called The Hypochondriac, and he played the lead role in this play. And in the midst of his performance of this play, he gets seized with a coughing fit. Within hours after the performance, he's dead. It wasn't an imaginary illness. He was really sick. Or the story of Bob Cartwright, who was supposed to join two of his friends on a plane to go watch the Tigers play the Yankees in a playoff game. It didn't work out for him. He was totally bummed. He missed the flight. And then his two friends were killed in a plane crash. He said, "I should have been on that flight." Well, within a month after that, he himself was dead in another plane crash at his home in California. Or the story of Donald Peters, who on November 1st, 2008, went out to buy a lottery ticket, as he had done every year for the 20 years before that. And that day, he bought the winning $10 million lottery ticket and died the same day he bought it of a heart attack. You don't know when your time is coming. The writer of Ecclesiastes would not have been surprised about any of these things because he says time and chance happen to them all. Man does not know his time. You don't know your time. And that's why it's silly for us to worry and be anxious about our lives, because the things that we worry about generally aren't the things that get us. It's the things we don't see coming, like the car that runs the red light and blindsides us on some random Wednesday afternoon. Wisdom is being prepared to die, not knowing when it's going to happen, but knowing that it is going to happen. And so consequently, enjoying the gifts that God has given us, and enjoying the gifts that God has given us is dependent upon our being prepared for the fact that this life is going to come to an end. So let me ask you, are you prepared to die? Are you really ready? That includes some practical things, like have you prepared a will, maybe a living will? Is your house in order? But it's far more fundamental. Are you ready to die? If you do not know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are not prepared to die. And if you don't know that you know him, you are not prepared to die. Because what the Bible says is a certainty is that you will die. And the other certainty is that after death comes the judgment. And you will give an answer to God for every word, every thought, everything you did, and everything you didn't do that you should have done. And I can assure you of this. The Bible says all of us have sinned. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. None of us are prepared to face that judgment on our own. And God doesn't expect us to face that judgment on our own. In love, he gave his son to come and die on the cross. And what he was dying for there was not his own sin. He was dying for the sins of people like you and me so that we could be forgiven. So that when we stand before the judgment of God, we stand there not on the basis of the good and bad that I've done, but on the good that Jesus has done and that he's given to me and that I've received by faith alone. It's a gift. This salvation we speak of is a gift. And you just simply receive it by believing that Jesus has done this for you. And if you have received it, if you haven't received him, today you can. You can go out of this room with confidence that when you die and you stand before God, he will welcome you into his presence. And whatever life you have between now and then, you can begin to live without the fear of death. And so really begin to enjoy life and to live life in a way you never have before. For those of you who know Jesus is your Savior and have no reason to fear death, well, let's look at it squarely in the face once again and embrace the reality that we are going to die. Are we enjoying the simple gifts he's given us now? Are we making the most of the opportunities we have now that we won't have once we enter into heaven? There's still time. You're still that living dog, better than a dead lion. Brothers and sisters, you are dying. Let's begin to live wisely by living like we're dying for the glory of God and for the good of our neighbors. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank you that we don't have to guess about the future, but that you hold it in your hands and you hold us in your hands. And that whatever comes to us, whether it seems good or bad to us, we know all of it has come through the hands of our Father who loves us, who gave Christ on the cross to reconcile us and to ensure us a place in the new heavens and new earth forever. May we not look to our circumstances, but to the cross to know how you feel toward us. For those who haven't trusted you, I pray they won't go out of this place today before they bow their knee to you, invite you into their life, invite your forgiveness, and receive the gift of eternal life. And for all of us, may we go forth from this place and begin to live wisely, to live like we're dying. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.